It's a pleasure for me to have here with us Professor Luciano Maiani. He's a distinguished particle theorist who received a Dirac Medal at ICTP in 2007 together with John Iliopoulos for their fundamental work on what is known as the Gym mechanism, which led to the discovery of the fourth quark, the charm quark. We will talk about that. But Luciano also has a very close connection with ICTP. He has been a very strong supporter of ICTP in his role as the chair of the Scientific Council for many years. And he also has many hats. He was the Director General of CERN, and the major particle accelerator facility, also the president of INFN. He had other scientific and personal connections with ICTP, with Salam. So we just want to discuss with him, chat with him about various aspects of his career and life. So maybe we can start with the Gym mechanism from from your youth, your youthful days, as I know. Yeah, first of all, so I should say for the audience, I mean, this is a very milestone in the particle physics of the 60s and the 70s, which led to, until then, that this, it was believed that there were only three quarks, really the fundamental constituents of matter, which make up nuclear matter. But their work sort of necessitated, required the presence of a fourth quark. So that's what I want to ask you about. How did these three names get associated with each other? What was your path to the discovery? Where did you meet John? How did it happen?
Yes, well, the Gym mechanism was a turning point in my career and also in my life. Looking in retrospective, it was prepared by several encounters that made up the atmosphere. And first of all, I had the pleasure to work with Nicola Cabibbo, and we worked on the weak interactions and many, many, many aspects of particle physics. I started working with Nicola in around 67. A little before, I met Shelley Glashow in the Varenna School. In fact, was my first physics school, and was much impressed by his talk about charm. That was the time in which they thought that there should be a fourth quark. They were not the only ones. Other people proposed that. But they were somehow out of scale, because they thought that the indication of the fourth quark was the Phi meson. And so the charm meson had to be found mixed with the K meson. And that was the subject of his lecture in Varenna, which concluded by saying that there is no fourth quark. Then later on, what happened is around 68, there was this famous paper by Joffe and Chabalin that pointed out the difficulties to explain the neutral current in the Cabibbo theory. That raised an enormous wave of interest. In particular, there were people that tried to use these singularities that had been found in the higher order weak interactions to as a way to compute the mysterious Cabibbo angle. And I worked with Nicola in 68 about that. We had a proposal, etc. And in 68 and in 69. Then I decided I was just about to marry my wife Pucci, and decided that I had to make an experience in the United States. And in fact, I received two offers, one from Caltech and the other one from Harvard. I still remember one day in which I had these two letters and said, what should I do in Caltech? And I thought it would be very difficult to interact with my heroes like Feynman, Gell-Mann, etc. And on the other hand, I had Harvard, where there was a Sid Coleman that I knew because he had spent 1 year in Rome, and Shelley Glashow that I knew from, and I knew what he was doing. And so finally I decided to go to Harvard. And we arrived in November, and we could start immediately working together because Shelley had been following this thing. John Iliopoulos as well had worked on higher order weak interaction. And so we started essentially arguing among each other with normally one guy at the blackboard trying to explain something and the other two sitting down trying to destroy what he was doing. And from November, we arrived to January. In January, I think we really, at least I and also the others, put to focus that the real problem was not computing the Gabibbo angle. The real problem was to cure this fact that to have a reasonable agreement with the experiments, neutral currents, you had to introduce an ultraviolet cutoff, extremely small. And so we tried to find an amplitude that would cancel we tried several things, but all of a sudden it appeared to us that the old quark of Shelley Glashow would do the matter. Mm. It was really a surprise, and would do the matter, would do the business. Not only, but it turned out that he had to have a mass which was completely out of scale with respect to the quark masses that we knew. The three quarks, two are very light, and the third one is a strange quark, which has a mass you can compute in different ways, but anyway will be of the order of the Kao mass. Yeah, right. While this quark has to be a mass of 1.7, 1.5, 1.7 GeV. And that was very surprising, but by the way, saved the old idea of CERN, because it said that CERN particles are much higher. So the fact that had not been found was not anything strange. And we were really very excited, and we decided to go to illustrate our work to Francis Law, who was an old wise man. And so we went, we remember, we took a bus, we went there and started discussing with Francis Law, and at some time Steve Weinberg appeared.
So Law was at MIT?
MIT.
Okay, right.
Steve Weinberg appeared.
Who was also at MIT at the time.
He was at MIT. Of course, Shelley had been a school friend of Weinberg and explained to him. Steve was very negative. He didn't like the idea and tried to destroy it, saying that higher order interaction, strong interaction will destroy this cancellation, etc., etc. So, okay. But we left like that. We decided to publish the paper anyway. It had some story with the referees, but nothing strange. And in fact, in springtime, it went out. I must say that I had problems. My wife was expecting a baby. She had a problem. She lost it. We decided to come back to Italy. So, in fact, my stay in Harvard was from November to May. Everything happened in this short period. I come back to Rome and found Nicola working with younger people. One, the youngest was Giorgio Parisi, by the way, about a new result which was found with Adone, the E plus E minus machine which had just started. And they found an anomalously large production of hadrons. And Nicola and Testa worked with the quark model and say that the ratio to the mu plus mu minus cross section was q square, etc. So that was a way to explore the nature of the constituents. But of course, Adorno was in a region low, and this was 1970. We arrived in 1974. Nicola was always at the beginning very skeptical about CERN. He didn't really like the idea. He wanted some non-perturbative thing that could compute the angle. And but finally, in 1974, he got convinced that there was the discovery of the neutral currents. Mm-hmm. He was convinced, and we were trying to tell to the experimentalist in Frascati to push the energy of the machine. We have to remember that Adorno's top energy was 3 GeV.
Okay.
It's a critical number.
That's right.
Because in November 74, it arrived the news that the JPSI had been found at 3.1
yes.
GeV. Of course, Frascati made a terrible effort to push, and in 1 week they arrived, and they also observed the particle. And then another saga came out, because of course the first hypothesis for JPSI was CC-bar. I mean, what else could be? But there was a problem for that, that was pointed out by several people, that the width of the JPSI was extremely small,
yes.
Much smaller than we had estimated with Shelley and John Iliopoulos, a few MeV, etc. It was 100 keV, it was very, very small. And so at this point, the various options came out. We thought it could be the W. And now I come with Salam, because in 74, with Guido Altarelli, we done a very nice paper explaining the delta equal 1/2 rule of non-leptonic weak decays as an effect of QCD renormalization, which preferred the I equal 1/2 operator with respect to I 3/2. It's still the present explanation. And so I came here to Trieste to give a seminar that was not much later than the discovery, of course, of the JPSI, I think around end of 74, something like that, or perhaps beginning of 75. And Salam was very, he liked very much our work. He said, you have opened up a new industry of computation of yes. higher order QCD, etc. But while I was here to give the seminar, Nicola called me and said, look, they found the JPSI prime, so it's not the W. It's Shelley is right. Mm. What that Shelley found was the paper by the work by Politzer and company, who were in Harvard, by the way, that explained the width of the JPSI with asymptotic freedom.
Yes.
This was a totally new thing that yes. we had not considered. And that was an obvious explanation. And the formula that Nicola had found for Nicola Parisi and Testa had found for the Adorno cross-section was immediately used to see that after the JPSI, the cross-section had increased. Uh-huh. And that was the signal of production of a new quark.
Yes.
It was uh-huh. correctly interpreted like that. And then in 76, there was the observation of the upsilon. And the observation of CERN quark, and so the thing.
Yes, that's
finished. I mean, as Shelley had anticipated to my wife in the January 1970, when she said that I was, she told Shelley how much I was excited of this paper and this work, etc. He said, "Yes, he's right. This is going to be on all school books."
which is true.
It was not far from. Not far from. Not far from.
So reality. Just this 6 months, the 6 months visit,
in six
being
months,
in the right place.
Even less, because even less. Most of the 6 months were spent just trying one and the other and harmonizing our views, etc. And for what I remember, it was January. In January, we really focused that, and the problem was, it's a very simple problem to solve. If somebody say this is the problem,
yes.
Well, after all, it's not so difficult to find. It was a wonderful idea, and that changed my life.
Yeah, it also changed the subject, because, not only also in physics, I think, also this idea of having loop correct quantum
and
corrections.
And other things that you do in your life. But this it was really something that I could not think a best day. I was very, we may change the argument now, but I was, at that time, I was, even before we arrived to CERN, I was so excited about the quarks. That was really the time where really the idea had come, that I remember spending evening with my wife, who was a physicist, by the way, not working, but was a colleague
trained
of mine, explained to her how beautifully the quark would explain meson, baryons. And we spent a whole evening, I remember, speaking about that until late in the night. It really was a wonderful idea.
So and, this was a romantic conversation of physicists.
Yes.
I see. That's very interesting. So what was your interaction with John? I know John also from the Paris days. You more or less worked independently of each other? Or this was your only... time when
John was a surprise in a way, because arriving in Harvard, I met him for the first time. I never met him in person before. Uh-huh. It turned out that we have essentially the same age. He's 1 year older than I am. We have we have everything in common. We like diving. We like going to the seaside. We like good kitchen.
Good food.
Good food.
Because I know that
We like to cook.
Yes, I mean.
So the friendship with John started and has never ended. I still heard him 2 days ago on the telephone, and of course, whenever I go to Paris,
Yes, yes. John is actually, as you know, he's like a Michelin star chef.
Sure.
And he really loves to cook, and he has this huge, amazing collection of wines.
Yes.
And he loves to invite physics friends
and treat them
to these nice parties of great food.
Yes. I have a good picture, a good photo of a dinner in John's house in Paris, where there is Shelley and John. There is, of course, the two Iliopoulos with a small kid, and the two Maiani with a small daughter.
So
it's a wonderful picture. And so it was a friendship that started there then, and lasted for our lifetime. And because really it's difficult to find people. We always agree when we discuss about something, except when we were in Harvard, that we were
arguing with each
fighting
other.
Each other, say, you do not understand anything.
No, and it's wonderful to have your name sort of scientifically associated with such a good friend, right? I mean, so
yes.
It's always going to be... G-I-M is going to be. That's great. And what was the interaction between theory and experiment? I mean, in a way, this JPSI was between theory and experiment, because the JPSI discovery was probably quite independent of your work, or was it influenced?
The discovery was independent, although after we made the paper on CERN, one of the last thing we did, I did, while I was still in the States, was to go and tell something. because I was a good friend of something. I met him in Brandeis School in 1967. We had also developed a very nice friendship. And we went to him, and I knew that he was looking for E plus E minor, because he was after the famous shoulder that found which was the Japes Eye, the Lederman shoulder, and so we went to him and said, look, you have to look for that. You will have to find the vector meson, which should be around 3 GeV or something, with a width of a few MeV.
That was not bad.
In fact, when I left Harvard, I have to say that the family of my wife did not like airplanes. So her father managed to find for us a first-class cabin on a boat that goes from Boston back to Italy. And so, when you have a cabin in a first class, the only thing you have to do is to make a party for your friends. And so friends arrived. It was Shelley, it was John Iliopoulos, something, and another physicist of Harvard that I don't remember now, a condensed matter physicist. And Shelley had brought an enormous amount of champagne. So we had a party, and at the end, we had to kick them out because the boat starts. And Shelley was going to a conference in, I think, in Philadelphia, something like that. It is the conference in which he said the famous sentence, you have to find charm particles, and if you don't find them, I will eat my hat.
Okay. Confidence of a theorist.
To say that he was really confident about it.
So let me actually ask you to your some other roles that you have played. You have been the Director General of CERN at some quite critical times of CERN. You were also the President of CNR. So do you want, being a leader of sort of a major international organization like CERN, can you recall some difficult decisions you had to make or some decisions that you're particularly proud of in terms of direction of the field?
Well, that is an unforgettable experience, because you are in a great laboratory with enormous amount of good people that you can interact. In addition, we were in a very transition period, because CERN had approved the LHC in 1994. At that time, I was in the council as president of INFN. So I had contributed to that. And then after Llewellyn Smith, I came in as director in 99, and the construction of LHC had started in 97. So you can imagine that you had just at the very beginning with problems, with tunnels, with the hole, etc. But the real problem came because the plan foreseen closing LEP to make space for the LHC, because you have to make another tunnel, etc. And that was a very difficult time, because there were events that looked like inviting to stay and to continue, and that was very difficult because it was very expensive and would disrupt the thing. And so finally we had to come to a decision, and we make the decision to close it, and it raised a lot of things, etc. Fortunately, it was the right decision. First of all, because the Higgs boson was not there.
It was a signal for the Higgs boson, a supposed signal with not so high.
The signal was not so high. That was the reason to close, because you could not go anywhere with LEP. And uh, so, uh, So I'm very happy. Then, second point, there was a crisis of the cost, because of course, extra cost accumulated, and then there were expenses that had not been included, etc. So we had to face the amount that there was a large amount of money to find. But again, here, I think CERN is very resistant. We found a very good solution to share the extra cost one side from CERN side by closing a good number of activities, and from the other side by prolonging the repayment period for the council. So in the end, it all went well. Mm-hmm. And LHC is a splendid machine, working beautifully. And I dedicated the 5 years of my lifetime there, essentially to put forward that.
To make the LHC happen in a way.
To make it possible. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we had foreseen to start the LHC in 2007, but LHC started 4 years later because of accidents, etc., that were not part of the plan. And so I think everything went beautifully.
Okay, and then I've had the privilege of working with you as the chair of the Scientific Council. So ICTP is also an international organization, much smaller than CERN. I sometimes say it's like a CERN without the accelerator. It's like CERN with a blackboard in that it's more theory. What is your impression of ICTP and of SALAM and the mission of ICTP?
ICTP is smaller than CERN, of course, yes. but has its character, yes. And the SALAM imprint. So it has been a very... I did not expect to be called here. In fact, Nicola was the chair of the Scientific Council, and I was called as successor of Nicola, I did it very happily, and I'm only positive experience of this period. Of course, there are ups and downs, there are difficulties, budgets, etc., but basically speaking, it's a wonderful experience in a very healthy surrounding, which is my surrounding.
Yes.
A mix of theory and experimentalists, etc. So this is my world. And so I've never had any problem being at ICP, only I enjoyed. But I had enjoyed also before coming as a professor, as a visitor to the summer school. As I said, I have very good relation with SALAM. I had many friends here from Furlan, who was a really good friend of mine, to Albert Occhi, etc. So ICTP has always been a place where I would come very happily.
No, we are very happy to have you. Maybe a couple of quick questions. So, I mean, I remember recently there was a discussion in the European Research Council about blue sky research versus
That happened in 2019, mm-hmm. in September, when the new government, new European government of the van der Leyen has been done, and I don't know for what reason, but probably responding to pressures from technology, etc. She wanted to suppress the name research in the title given to the commissioner. So we, with many friends, considered that was not a good move. We make a lot of lobbying for that. We raised a good number of signatures, including many Nobel Prizes, etc., to say, no, the name research has to stay as one of the aims of the European Union. And finally, the thing was settled. It was also good to have Fabio in the ERC committee at the time, because it was an internal voice. Fabio Zirner, and so I think this started another activity, which is lobbying for fundamental research.
Yes, yes.
And I think this is still very important, yes, because as my friend Lorenzo Foa said once, he's not sure that fundamental research will lead to new technology, but it is sure that without fundamental research, you will not have new, yes, technologies. Yes. So.
No, I think that's a very, especially for a place like ICTP, where I mean the vision is that we do contribute to the, yes, developing world, but doing research at blue sky, which apparently has no immediate implication for the problems at hand. But it's an essential component of your development strategy.
Yes, this is a lobbying that has continued with the present government, with Mario Draghi, etc. And now there is a committee, which includes Ugo Amaldi, that studies the way to bring the funding of basic research in Italy to the same level as France and Germany.
Oh,
we are a step below. And this explains, is the simple explanation of why our good people then go abroad. Mm-hmm. And we explain that in many ways, in letters, etc. I hope that this will come and it will be understood that bringing Italy to the level of other top countries in Europe is not an option, is a necessity.
It's a necessity,
and,
yes.
And to keep our good people, and also other people from abroad, in Italy, it's essential. And
yes,
we have a structure that are able to form good people, so the means and the professor are not bad. And but then most of them go abroad.
Economic pressures.
You now hired an Italian mathematician, a lady mathematician, yes, that has been formed in Italy, was abroad, and now she's coming back to Trieste. That's a good success.
Yes, yes. Okay, one final question about, you also have been active in issues related to more socially oriented issues like nuclear security, and which is a very urgent problem. I mean, the bulletin of atomic scientists have raised the threat level very close to midnight. So along with climate, this is really, we sort of think that the problem has gone away, but it's actually in the current atmosphere, it's actually getting perilously close. You have been organizing this Amaldi conference, so do you want,
yes,
to comment something about?
Yeah, but just a small, I entered this business by chance, mm-hmm, because when I was president of CNR, a delegation of my friends of mine came to me and said, we would like to have some support in money for the Amaldi conference. So I get to know that was there, and in fact, I gave a small funding. And but the impression that I had was a strange impression, a club of old people that were saying to themselves how good they've been to have the disarmament, the non-proliferation treaty, etc. So I thought that was no good. But then I was asked to organize myself, and we changed totally
the character.
We invited the people from West, from the East, from Israel, from Iran, from China,
Russian,
Pakistan,
Russia,
India, etc. All the critical things.
Yes.
Of course, Russians, Americans, and Europeans were already there. So now the Amaldi conference is a wider panorama. We had a series of very good conferences, and I got very much interested. The real problem is that since 2015, when we did the first, when I organized myself the first Amaldi conference, things are going from bad to worse.
Yes.
Because there has been the Trump action to destroy all the number
agreements,
of treaties, mm-hmm, and then on top of that, the Ukrainian war. So it's very interesting to compare the title of the third Amaldi conference. The title was Going from Confrontation to Cooperation. To the title of our last Amaldi conference, which is Security and Armed Control in the Time of Pandemics and War.
Wow.
It's a big difference.
It's a big difference.
And we have to be very worried. And I hope that civil society will raise his head and say this has to, we have another turnover. We have again to go from confrontation to cooperation.
Yes, absolutely.
We cannot.
Yeah, you know, I think it's not a road that
divide the world in blocks that hate each other, etc. And now my action at the moment is to convince CERN not to cut the agreements with the Russian scientists.
Yes.
Because that has been, over the past, a channel of communication fantastic.
Yes.
Remember in the 50s, in the 60s, scientists spoke to each other. They knew each other. They had the esteem of one each other. So the two societies had a channel.
There was a
common
dialogue, yes.
And now we have to avoid, to break this channel. I had a wonderful collaboration with Russia when I was at CERN. We made many things together, and I have many friends, and we cannot simply cut the world into two that don't speak to each other.
Yes, so, no, I think this is very also so close to the spirit of ICTP. As you know, here is the place where,
of course,
even during the Iron Curtain, many people, this
sure
is a place where the dialogue can happen.
It's so something that has to stay.
That has to really be preserved. It's worth fighting for, I would say. So thank you very much, Luciano. It was a great pleasure to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you.